Hello, everybody. Welcome to our webinar. And this is the second webinar in our series about Virtuozzo Application Platform for WordPress. In this one, we will dive deep into the application platform, and we will show you a short demo how the technology works. My name is Nikolai Nedev, and I'm joined here by my colleague Theodore Filipidis. We're both working at the strategic development team, and we will take you through today the Virtuozzo application platform with a quick introduction. This is the agenda that you see in front of you. We will show you what the platform looks like, how it behaves from infrastructure as a service to platform as a service. Then we will discuss some deployment methods, and we will show in depth how it works with the logic behind the scenes. We will finish with a demo and a Q&A session at the end. And regarding the Virtuozzo application platform for WordPress, as many of you have already seen on the previous webinar, where we've shown the high level of this platform, we offer a very advanced solution for deploying WordPress instances on infrastructure or public private cloud environments, on different environments with a lot of amazing features like automated clusterization, vertical and horizontal scaling based on the resource consumption. We offer improved security compared to other solutions out there with intuitive management and self-service portals that are white labeled as well. And from this point on, I will pass you on to my colleague who will discuss the deployment methods, and he will show you further on and show you the demo as well. Theo, the stage is yours.
Hello. Hello, everyone. Thank you for attending this webinar. In the past weeks, we've looked at the dashboard's highest level. Today, however, we will dive deep into how the platform works. There are two different deployment methods. One is based on local storage, and the other provides high availability in the underlying infrastructure, and it's based on Virtuozzo storage. We will also show the scheme of deployments for proof from proof of concept to high performance computing. For production, we suggest 10G networking, and for high performance, 25G networking. Of course, bonding is supported via LACP. For Virtuozzo storage, SSD disks are preferred. Of course, NVMEs will provide higher IOPS and maximum performance for critical workloads. The platform itself is infrastructure agnostic and can be deployed to any infrastructure, but there are some limitations through, mainly with the networking when selecting some specific cloud vendors for the deployment, as we can see on the current slide. But let's go deeper into the infrastructure components and the infrastructure containers and how it works behind the scenes. Next slide, please. On this slide, we can see the overall architecture and the components of the orchestrator. And now we will go deeply to see each individual one. The zookeeper is responsible for coordinating and configuring the delivery of the infrastructure modules during the platform maintenance and upgrades of from our engineers. The database is built in redundancy for high availability, and it's responsible for storing the system information such as user environments, data, billing history, consumption history, and many more information that is being stored into. The serverless servers are acting as they are responsible for the ingress traffic, and when the user would like to have the application without external IP addresses, they can directly be delivered through the serverless servers. However, it is possible to attach external IP directly to the environment, of course, on the web application server, or if it's a clustered environment, to the load balancer. The workener is responsible for wake up the containers when they've been in suspend mode or when they are in hibernation mode. And this is very useful for staging environments to be more cost efficient solution for the developers. The Hivex core is responsible for internal actions for the account management, application hosting, and actions that is been for start-stop environments, editing environments, create environments, and many, many other actions that it's built in the core logic. The Virtuozzo Application Platform core is responsible also to enable high availability to bind external domains to migrate environments, and this is possible also with live or offline migration. The statistics has been responsible for collecting information about the consumption of the containers itself in the respective system resources, such as CPU, memory, disk space, and disk IOPS and IO. Of course, they provide real-time data to the end user through the dashboard. In the billing, it's responsible for collecting all the usage that has been placed from the containers. As always, we need to note here that our solution, it provides hybrid billing based on fixed pricing, but also dynamic pricing for real resource consumption, on the real resource consumption. The SSH gate, it provides external SSH access management through a centralized point. The users, they have the ability to attach a public key and then to be able to connect through this gateway and manage all the environments and the containers from their beloved SSH client. In addition, we provide a web gate that it's possible for the end users to access SSH via our web interface. It's really flexible and quickly accessible for the end users. The uploader is responsible for the users that would like to apply their version and their CI/CD through like a zip or dark zip, something like this. They can upload their own private repo that it's been maintained into the orchestrator itself. And the pool manager, it's an internal module for managing the IP pools for private and external network, and it's responsible for the allocations and deallocations of the IP addresses into the containers. The puppet, it's an infrastructure component for deploying and update the hardware nodes on the Virtuozzo application platform and the internal containers too. And the Zabbix, it's a built-in integration to monitor the infrastructure containers, the software stacks, but also it can be add external services on demand, such as the backup server and many, many other technologies. And how we patch the production systems. There is no downtime for the user workloads. We patch the infrastructure nodes by placing a maintenance page for the administrator and the user panels. These tasks usually take up to 3 hours to do this task. Next, we will see the topologies that you can deploy and to create WordPress applications. First, it's a standalone topology in which we combine all the software stacks with the same instance. It gives vertical scaling and resizes whenever a user resizes the instance without downtime. We optimize the software stacks on every resize so it will be always optimal. And this is very important because it's reducing significantly the day-to operations, and of course it gives an extended knowledge behind the scene into the to solve the right sizing boxing issues. Next, we see the clustered environment, which benefits from vertical and horizontal scaling. It provides high availability and can support auto-scaling based on system triggers that can be configured on the system resources. This includes CPU, memory, networking, disk I/O, and disk IOPS. Let's jump to a demo.
Just give me a second, please. Now I'll give you control. Go ahead.
I hope you can see my screen. Let me minimize this, please. Okay. So here is the end user panel. I will start by describing how the platform looks like for the end user perspective. We can see two different sections. It's starting from the high level. It's about the environments and the containers of the users, and give us full overall information with statistics and also access to some settings and configuration. The screen below, it's about the deployment manager, but also it's a workspace for the users when they want to manage their file system, when they want to see some statistics, and many, many other things that we will see in a bit. These sections are flexible, and we can have full screen for more wide workspace, but also it can be minimized so we can have full access to the current environments. Also, we have the top bar that the users can have the general settings, and here they can enable two-factor authentication, they can deploy their access tokens for some API calls if they want to have external access to their account, but also they can configure their public keys and private keys if they want to have some synchronization with Git, SSH access, and full collaboration on the account. On the bottom of the dashboard, we've seen that we have also the active tasks, but also we can go and see some historical data about the activity log. We can go back to the time, and also we can filter the errors only if we have some. It's really flexible, and full audit log, it can be applied here. Let me start how we create a new environment. The Virtuozzo Application Platform for WordPress is built in the top of our Virtuozzo Application Platform. That means it's utilizing the same engine and the same technology in the respect of scalability and flexibility. However, to simplify the process for the WordPress users, we have predefined packages based on some different criteria and different business models. We starting with standalone containers that it supports two different web servers. The one, it's based on Nginx and PHP FPM, and all the software stacks is being installed in the same instance. However, depends on the size, we optimize the software stacks based on the system resources of the container. This can be adjustable, and I will show you in a bit how it can be configured. Next, we see the standalone Pro that is based on the Lightspeed web server, and of course it provides the Lightspeed plugin for WordPress and some other built-in technologies for cybersecurity, for web security, sorry. It includes web application firewall, brute force protection for WordPress, and also basic DDoS protection that it's built in on the container level, and it's adjustable based on the system firewall. Next, we will see the WooCommerce, that it's optimal and tuned for e-commerce businesses based on engines, but also we offer Lightspeed solution. After, we will jump to the cluster. The cluster, it's an environment within the same data center that it's already pre-configured for high availability with redundant containers to all the isolated roles, because each individual role is built in the top of isolated container. That means the load balancers, they act as only for the load balancing, the web servers, etc. It's working only for this specific software stack within the same container. We have spent here a lot of time to improving the scaling logic when with the users, they have high load spikes. So we have some predefined scaling triggers that I will show you in a bit. However, the end user have the full control to configure its own scaling strategy exactly as he wants. The same applies for the WooCommerce cluster. And now I would like to introduce you our multi-region standalone cluster that can be deployed on different geographic data center located data centers. This can be within, let's say, same country, within the same data center as different availability zones with different networking, but also can be applied on different continents. So the end users can have more global distributed traffic for accessing new markets. In the next releases, we will have also multi-region cluster deployment, and this it will be distributed with different technologies. The one can be with asynchronous replication, and of course it's best practices for long distance data centers that they have response time below 20 milliseconds, I will say. But also we will support sync replication, that it's powered by Galera, and it can be deployed as best practices when the response time between the data centers are below 20 milliseconds. And next, we have an extra container here that is responsible for backup storage. This container can be in standalone deployment or cluster deployment based on ClusterFS. And of course, it can be deployed on different regions, so the users can take in backups for based on disaster recovery best practices and to don't store within the same data center. We are working to extend the capabilities on the backup to be able the user to restore new environments on different regions through some backup points. I will show you in a bit how the backup looks from within the environment. So here we are creating the storage that we would like to have our backups, but the management of the backups is coming within the environment, we will see in a bit. In the meantime, let me create a new cluster environment on Finland. As we can see here, the task is starting a procedure, how it is deploying the environment. It's starting, of course, from the infrastructure layer. We create the containers, we adding the software stacks within the container, and after we have another logic that is going to the application level, so we will sync up some for the file system, for the database, etc. Of course, the users, they have the ability to continue work on their workspace during the environment creation. Let's go to see some high level settings in the respect of the environment. We are starting with custom domains. The users can configure their own domain and to bind to this environment. Of course, this is very flexible because anytime they can go and they can clone the production environment to staging, as an example. And when they did their test, when they inject the new codes and would like to switch the production to the staging, on the staging, they can come directly here and swap the traffic between the environments. This, of course, provides the high-end flexibility and high availability to route the traffic on the new instance. And as always, it gives us an option to roll back to the previous state. As I mentioned before, an external IP address can be attached directly to the load balancers, and then the end user have the ability, of course, to configure its own A record and route directly the traffic into the environment and bypass the shared load balancers. However, for not utilizing a lot of external IP addresses, you can benefit from our shared load balancers. This starting with two for the initial deployment. However, as your workloads have been extended, the shared load balancers can be extended 2 to 4, 6, 8, etc. Next, I will show you the custom SSL. The users can easily attach any commercial SSL just by uploading the files, the private key, the CSR, and the intermediate. But also, this is happening. What's happening behind the scenes is when we scale up, scale on the cluster, everything is being redeployed. So we just need to upload once our SSLs, and after the orchestrator is taking responsibility for during the scalings and all these actions. However, we support, of course, Let's Encrypt too. The user is able to install directly through the add-ons, and their internal mechanism for auto renew when it's being close to expire date. I will return back to the environment settings, and we will see the SSH access. As we already saw on the presentations, we offer two methods. The one is through SSH gate and is accessible with a public key. Once the user connects to the gateway, it has full access to all the environments and hierarchically can jump between other containers. However, for faster access, we provide web SSH and directly the user can click on the container and it has immediately access to the system passwordless. Of course, we support some actions like copy paste directly to the console, and also we can duplicate the session and also to switch between other nodes when it's a clustered environment. Next, we see the endpoints. The endpoints are very flexible and useful when the user would like to connect, as an example, an external ERP or something like this when they are running e-commerce business to our internal database without to expose the containers with public and external IP address. We can come here to map the container. We can say a friendly name and the private port that we want to map. And directly, the system give us this host name with this port. And now, based on this endpoint and access URL, we can map the internal container with its private port. It's really, really flexible for accessing the containers without to be exposed to the public network. Next, we can see the firewall. And the firewall, it can be switched on and off fully on the full on the environment level. It will take down all the firewalls within the containers. And also there are predefined configurations that it's full adjustable and configurable. The users can come and disable some ports, or they can add their own rules through directly from the user interface. With this way, they do not need to be super experts on the operating system and firewall level. They can come directly and configure their own rules very, very easy. There are some different sources directly, so they can map to be accessible from all the networks or the local network only. And plus, we support related nodes to be added when they want to be accessible within the same environment from specific containers. And of course, it's follow up the scaling logic when we scale up the application servers. As an example, all these configurations is being reconfigurable to the other nodes. Here, I would like to stay a little bit more because I would like to give you an understanding how the fencing network works. Normally, the users in another solutions, they need to manage this different, and specifically on some policies based on users and environments. What we are doing here to reduce the complexity and to make it more easy for the end users is that we doing that behind the scenes based on our environment groups. As you can see here, we have the environment groups that the user can configure, of course, for better management, better organization, for easier access when they have multiple environments into their account. But once the environment has been located within the same environment group with the other environment, then it's automatically including this on the allowed networking. So once we combine two different environments within the same group, they will be able to communicate between them. And once we do not have same group, they cannot communicate between them. So it's fully automatically and happening behind the scenes. It's really flexible without complexity. Next, we see the load alerts that we have predefined rules. However, the user can go and configure its own based on cloudlets, that it's include memory and CPU, or individually to memory, individually to CPU, network, external or internal, and also on storage and disk IO and IOPS and the inodes. Of course, there are a full historic log here, so the users, they can go behind the time frame and see about some specific loads and when they've been happened. Next, we will see the auto horizontal scaling. Here, as I said previously, we have predefined configuration in the respect of the scaling strategy. However, the users can, let me increase a little bit here. They can remove the predefined ones and to add their own. They can enable triggers based on the container. Let's assume now on the application server, and of course based on specific system resource, like let's see on the CPU. So how it works? The user can configure its threshold based on its own needs and strategy. Let's assume here on 60%, and to remove the nodes when it will go below 30%. And the strategy can be based on how many minutes the threshold it was ongoing. This can be in 1 minute, on 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and of course it can be customizable higher, like 1 hour. And next is it's how many nodes we would like to scale and how many nodes we want to scale concurrently. And of course, for the end user to don't be overcharged after he receives some high load spikes, or he have, let's say, Black Friday or Cyber Monday, then it can, when all these users, it will go below 30% to reduce the cluster as it was previously before the load spike. It's really flexible. The user receives email notifications on every action, and of course there are also historical log that the users can see what happened and when it happened. It's really flexible and transparent. Next, we will see the collaboration. Collaboration can happen between another user accounts within the platform, but also can be to can invite external resources too. And it's really powerful because it's based on a role system. And this role system, it's really flexible and multi-tenant on which role you would like to configure and to and then user to create based on its own needs. So it can be enabled on environment level directly, or to manage to create environments, or not to create, just to edit environments, etc. But also it can go to the billing level, to accessing file system, to accessing the logs or the real-time statistics, to be able to reset password, and many other things. So it's really flexible on each individual component. It can have access or not. Next, we see the change owner. This is useful when, let's assume, a web agency would like to change the ownership or to deliver the project to the final user. This can be happen from here directly. You can then user can change ownership of environment, so it can convert and change, let's say, the billing. So it, he will not need to control the billing, but the final user. This is something useful to be applied. And next, we can see the migration. On the environment level, the end user can migrate from different regions. As we said on the previous webinars, in the same region, we can have also different hardware groups. When we have migration between different hardware groups, or the network configuration, external IPs, private IPs can be same. However, when they migrate between different regions and not hardware groups, as you understand, there will be some changes on the networking level for the private IP and the external IP too. Except if you have high advanced network configurations, any cast IPs and something like this. So I will close the high level settings on the environment level. And I will go a little bit to the container. Here we can see the floating menu that it's been adapted on each individual role. For the application servers, we have some predefined add-ons that the end user can enable easily with simple click, like FTP access to the container, some third-party services like we have here integration with BitNinja for security purposes. Premium CDN, Let's Encrypt SSL. They can also have environment start and stop scheduler. They can configure staging or development environment to be stopped on Sundays and on Saturdays and on specific time. This is very powerful for users to have more cost efficient architecture and design based on their production staging and development environments. Also, we have integration with New Relic for some debugging purposes and Git push deployment add-on for advanced developers when they would like to push directly the code from development environment to their repo and after to pull into the production. We have file synchronization and the backup add-on that the end users have full control. They have full control on their backup strategy. They can configure some predefined logic like in daily, weekly, monthly, or hourly. And of course, they can configure their own backup storage. They can have multiple backup storages on different regions, of course. and also they can configure their backup rotation. Next, they have the ability to customize the backup policy based on specific time zones, because if you have international customers, sometimes they rely on different time zones, their production time is totally different from the other world, and we give the ability to match their own systems. And for advanced users, they can have their own cron tab configuration directly. Let me install the add-on. During the installation, we can continue work on the other actions and options. Here we have the config. The config is having a directly access into the container file system. We have some favorite folders, depends of course of the software stack and the container role. And we have like here the php.tiny with predefined configurations. It's production ready. They do not need to do some changes here. However, if they want to increase some memory limits, PHP execution time, they can come easily directly here, do their adjustments, and after to save the file. Sorry, memory limit. Let's do it 256 megabyte, and we have the option to save only for the current instance, the current container, or if it's a clustered environment, we can save these new configurations on all the containers directly. Also, we have a drop down here on the clustered environment that you can switch between containers. They have the ability to work directly into the configurations files. They can work like a cloud IDE. They can write code directly here. They have some flexibility to search into the file, etc. Of course, we have again the options to save only for the current instance or to the old containers directly. Next, we can see the logs that the user do not need to enter through SSH access or through FTP to see some quickly information about error logs. We have PHP errors, access log directly from the dashboard. They can always download the file into their local computer, local laptops, something like this for further analysis. And also they can tail, or they can see based on pagination paging here. Next, we see the real-time statistics. It's been divided to CPU. We can see the limits, the red line, and the actual consumption with the blue line. And also we have the memory information, the networking in the respect of the external outbound, the external inbound. We have also the private networking for outbound and inbound too. It's really useful. And also we have statistics for the storage. It includes the disk limitation, the current disk usage, and also IOPS limitation and IOPS usage. And from here, we can now see the overall application servers, or we can go individually and see specific node by its ID. Next, it's the web SSH. We already seen this, and I will jump to redeploy containers. Currently, imagine you have 1000 VPS or 2000 virtual machines, and you need to do patches on this when some vulnerability arises from Red Hat. It's a normal thing. We always have such issues. And here, for critical patches, we patching all the containers from the orchestrator, and the user doesn't need to have any action. However, in some cases, the user would like to redeploy the full container on new version, like a new software stack version for Lightspeed. They can go to a higher version, and also they can change the PHP version too. So here it's Lightbit 6.0.11 and here it's 6.0.12. So the user can go directly and redeploy all the container. That it means it pull the image and press image from starting with the operating system, with software stacks and PHP versions, etc. And of course, this can be applied also to the SQL databases, to Redis, to storage containers, and they can be always up to date. They can configure sequential deployment with delay, and when it's a clustered environment, the load balancer is distributed accordingly the traffic, so it there is zero downtime. And of course, they can keep the volume data. For WordPress users, it's of course more useful to keep volume data, except if they have some more logic based on Git and with pre-hook and post-hooks, they can not keep the volume data and they can pull directly fresh code into the container. And as we have mapped the storage container with the file system directly into the web servers, there are no conflict or worry to lose any data, as it's been redeployed only the specific container and not the full environment. Next, we can see some quickly links, like for Lightspeed, as we've seen now, directly access to the admin panel, and also they can come and see some predefined variables and they can adjust here, like to be enabled the auto config or to be disabled. And what is auto config? As we said on the presentation, when the user they would like to benefit from vertical scaling and to resize the container, we always going and retune all the software stacks based on specific strategy. Currently, we can see that the resources it's been allocated for the computing on 90%, and for the Redis within on 10%. These are being full adjustable. Next, I would like to show you how they can deploy from their repo directly. Let me jump deployment manager. Here they can manage their repo from Git with authentication, with token or with private SSH key, as we said in the beginning, but also they can use some SVN. I have here the WordPress and I can deploy directly to the environment from the deployment manager or directly from the environment, like here. Let me show you. I can delete this and I can deploy, I can deploy the WordPress on master branch, and also I have some options to configure pre-hooks, post-hooks too. And there are some other options, like to check for auto-deploy updates, and this is when the user would like to have auto deployments after they release new code on the specific branch, like here we have the master. Then the orchestrator is taking the responsibility to auto-deploy the new codes. And of course, we can enable zero downtime deployment for continuously and seamless experience for the end users and the application. We have only 15 minutes remain. I would like to show you a little bit how you can utilize our engine. And here I have prepared an add-on on how the end users can easily, or your platform operators, or you can extend the marketplace and offer new plugins, etc. I have an example here on how we create a WordPress add-on. This is about add-on to create a new WordPress users directly without the end users to need to go to the WP admin, as an example. We have global, the password, it's random, it will create it randomly. Then we have the settings, some specific fields, and the type. And after we have the execution, what's happening on install? It will go to execute a command on the master, on the first container, because it's centralized the overall WordPress management. It doesn't need to be executed in the all containers if we are speaking for a clustered environment. And this is the command with its placeholders and everything dynamically. And we have also the success message. Let's do how it works. Let's see how it works. We import, and then we have the fields as we configured on the logic. We can say like here, testing user and test email, and the user role directly, it can be selected, and we choose in which environment we would like to apply this plugin. We install, and the user has been created in the WordPress. The user login, email, also the random password, and the user role. It's really, really flexible. And of course, you can utilize this with many, many, many other actions and to extend with another capabilities like third-party integrations and also to inject your own logic for more seamless experience. We have documentation on how it's working based on our cloud scripting. We have event list that you can subscribe on all of these events, like on alert. If an alert reaches the CPU, then you can inject some logic to scale or to get some notification or to log something, whatever you can inject your own strategy based on your own needs and your customers. And also, we have here the console log that the users can see about the process and during all of these actions that we created on the dashboard. Like here, we have on the end the add-on installation to create a new user. We have all the log here and how it operates. However, if you have some issues during the creation, you can always come on the debug console here and you can easily debug and see where is the error. I would like to save 10 minutes for QA. We were not able to see everything, but however, I believe we've seen many, many things in more details than the previous webinars. You can always reach me and we can have private session and for specific needs if you need. Thank you very much. I will jump to Nick. Thank you.
Thank you, Theo. Thank you very much for this demo. And we're now going to enter the Q&A session. Oh, sorry. And there are already a couple of questions. Theo, were you able to see them?
Maybe. Not really, sorry, I cannot.
Okay, then I will just tell you what the question was. So it's quite a long one, but regarding the role access permission, is there a create environment access permission planned without shared environment group? That's the first question from Raul. I don't know if you can answer it.
We have this already. On the general settings, you can have collaboration with the ability to create new environments, yes.
Okay. And second question again, same person regarding the role access permission, is there... Oh, actually, this is the same one, sorry. So there is another question. What kind of version of Virtuozzo Application Platform are we using today? I'm not sure.
It's on 7.2.1. As far as I know, yes.
Great. And then there is a WordPress with GlusterFS deployed. Is there a guide to install GlusterFS in Virtuozzo Application Platform?
We have this already. It's an optional. When the user creates the application, he can choose with GlusterFS or without GlusterFS. Of course, for local storage deployments, we suggest GlusterFS. When it's Virtuozzo storage, it can be live without ClusterFS as it is high available within the underlying infrastructure.
I see. Great. And I think the second one is kind of already answered. What are the advantages of ClusterFS instead of some other kind of storage type? I guess that's
your. For the multi-region deployments in the clustered environment, we rely on ClusterFS and with their own geo-replication technology. It's really reliable and flexible. We are working with this for the multi-region and global deployments.
Okay, and next one is WordPress deployed as Kubernetes containers?
No, it's Virtuozzo containers, and of course it gives more flexibility for the end users. They can have easily SSH access without they need some specific permissions and privilege or unprivileged containers, but also you can allow them if you want to have deeper access into the container with root user, and also they can have YAML installed and such things. Yes.
Okay. And is there an automated way to validate automatic scaling cloudlets in WordPress, like some stress tool to prove it?
We have Gmeter, and with end user reactions and actions logic, we can share, and you can use our cluster for testing this environments. However, we have some benchmarks that we can share with you with some another load users, like 2000 users, 5000 users, 10,000 users, etc. But also all of this is being already tested by our engineers. So some predefined packages that we are delivering for specific scaling strategy, you will be able to configure, depends on the size of the business, like for small business, for small enterprises, for enterprises. We already have some logic and of course knowledge, and we can share with you.
Okay, and last couple of questions. What implementation is that backup restore option? How is it implemented?
So we currently mount this through NFS, and it works like local storage. We have implemented RESTIC for full backups and incremental backups, but we are going to extend with this with S3, with SFTP and some other logic, so you can integrate it also on your premises or to send it on external resources without to need to be deployed within the dashboard and within the cluster itself. Yes.
And another one, what is the use
I'm sorry, just to note something that I forgot to say, is that the service provider, yeah, it's a Virtuozzo backup technology that it can get full backup of the containers without the end user to be aware of this. So you can have your own backups for the containers, and the end user can have its own backup strategy too, individually.
Okay. And what is the use of cloud scripting tab?
The cloud scripting is that we allow to access our engine technology, so you can create your own solutions too. You can extend our, let's say, based images with your own plugins. You can have predefined bundle plugins, or you can have more logic within, like to connect third-party services. You can easily enable some actions within the dashboard for your platform operators too, but also for the end user. You can share some plugins for better management and more functions and features within the same product.
All right, and last few questions. Is there a recovery plan for the ClusterFS deployments?
We have built-in health checks and cluster diagnostic, yes. And this is applied also to the databases, because we have also auto-scalable databases. And this is when you configure some triggers, We not only scale the container, we are going behind the scenes and we adding the new node to the cluster, we replicate the data, everything, and after we inject this through proxy SQL and it's be able to distribute to the environment in production level. And of course, when the environment is scaled in again, we are going behind the scene and we release this node based on best practices and everything is happening automatically.
Great, thank you. And the last one, I think actually I can also answer it very quickly. Can I host Virtuozzo WordPress platform on our hosting servers deployed in different locations? Maybe you can just add Theo to my answer. I can confirm, yes, you can do this, but because we are platform agnostic. So as Theo mentioned in the beginning, we support also different vendors, different locations. So you have multiple options pretty much. Anywhere you want to host it, it can be done. Theo, I don't know if you want to add to anything to this.
I would like just to note, maybe because you were not able to attend on previous webinars, we said and we've shown that you can deploy on the different regions, on different data centers from the same panel. So it's one orchestrator and you can control all your data centers within the same panel. Yes.
Yeah. Perfect. And last two questions, and I think we will close the Q&A session because we're pretty much running out of time here. How could we test the effect from the vertical scaling? What instruments could we use for load testing?
You can use any third-party service, but also, as we said previously, we can give you access to our G-meter so you can have some more closer to the end user actions, log into the backend, create new posts, create new users, and not only a cache page. So we have full technology and we can support you with this.
Great. Awesome. Well, thank you very much, Theo. And thank you everyone for attending this webinar. We will, if you're interested in more information, you can reach out to us on the link here, on the email address, and we will send within 48 hours an email to everybody so you can watch the recording of this session. And as a final word, we do have a third webinar of this series that will focus on the business side of the platform, how to monetize the Virtuozzo application platform for WordPress. We will do this on the 13th of July, and we'll be happy to see you again there. And yeah, thank you everybody. I hope you enjoyed it and got some useful information from this. I wish you a wonderful day and evening, and goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.